Welcome to the Filmlinks Podcast,
a bi-weekly podcast where we analyze all that goes into effective filmmaking.
I'm Jonathan.
And I'm Alex.
And this is episode 70, Tricky Tati. We hit a zero, Alex. We're up to 70.
Yeah. Oh, man, that's so many. That's a lot of movies, guys. It's a lot of movies.
And we're back out in the foreign world with a French director, Jacques Tati, who is delightfully hilarious.
Yeah. We like throwing in these foreign episodes occasionally. We very much enjoy doing them. But yes, we are talking about a foreign director today, the wonderful and fantastic Jacques Tati, who only made like 6 feature films in the course of his lifetime, but they're all epic and wonderful and great and so rich and full of detail, like a Where's Waldo painting, and you can just look at him forever. But first, let's talk about the man before we talk about the movie. So Jacques Tati was born in France as Jacques Tatischeff. And if you're thinking, huh, that doesn't sound like a French name, not the Jacques part, the Tatischeff part, you're right. He's actually descended from a Kievan Russian aristocratic, formerly royal family that used to rule the Kievan Russian Empire in like the 1400s or 1200s or something like that. So literally descended from royalty. That doesn't really have anything to do with his own life now, but just explaining the name, which he would eventually shorten to Jacques Tati to sound way more French. He was trained in the family business from a young age to become a picture framer one day. However, that's not what he would end up doing. He ended up becoming a semi-pro rugby player, where he would often reenact plays in funny pantomime skits for his fellow teammates in order to make them laugh. So laying the roots for this guy's comedy career. And also, I do want to point this out, he is an athlete. He's a very physical person on screen and in his comedy. Not a lot of talking, which we'll talk about how much he doesn't talk later on. But all of his stuff is very, very physical. A lot of these great comedians that we've studied, like Chaplin, tend to be very physical like this.
Yeah, even up to the last film that we're going to be talking about today, he's still like climbing walls and doing his own stunts.
Yeah, he's pretty old at that point. He's been around the block for a bit. Right around the turn of the Great Depression, he does something crazy when a depression's happening and goes into comedy. And he becomes a famous stage performer with his Impressions Sportives. I probably mispronounced that by pronouncing the consonants. I apologize. But he's essentially taken his sport pantomiming act on stage and become famous through it. He would take a break for World War II, as all French would, to fight in the war and so on. And after the war, he would appear in a series of short films, not really connected, just kind of as an extra or side character in those films. He almost landed a part in one of the most famous French films of all time, Les Enfants du Paradis, which translates to The Children of Paradise, and is this epic historical French movie that was actually shot and recorded during World War II. It's very good, part of the Criterion Collection, do recommend. But eventually, he and a friend would found their own production company and make a short film called School for Postmen, which would eventually go on to become a longer feature film known as Jour de Fête, which was his first feature film. And all of these feature, you know, acrobatic stunts, comedy, all of that. They originally wanted...
On a bike.
Yeah, on a bike. The big theme of the first two is that he's on a bike. In a small French village. Originally they wanted to get somebody else to direct the film, but that guy dropped out. So Jacques Tati stepped in and directed as well as starred in the film, and that kind of became the thing where he would direct his own movies. And clearly that led to good results. So we're all happy for that guy dropping out of that movie way back when. He would take breaks as he got tired of doing the character of Mr. Hulot. He would make both Monsieur Hulot's Holiday and Mon Oncle, and then he would take a very long break before returning for Playtime, both because Playtime took a very long time to make, and because he just kind of got tired of the character. He would go off and do other things, appear in other movies for other people, do his own stage act. He's one of those guys who liked to change it up. He didn't like to get stuck in a rut so much, which is actually a theme in some of his movies.
Right.
And yes, of course, I mentioned it before, but it is important to note that this guy only ever made 6 movies ever, which is crazy. For such a prolific talent to not have that prolific of a catalog. But that's okay, because if you look at any one of his movies, they have the detail of like 3 movies shoved into them.
Yeah.
So it's more like he made 18 movies. They just have the runtime of 6 movies.
Yeah, and they're all so good and so intentional. And the 3 that we'll be focusing on today are all dealing with the character of Monsieur Hulot. And the first one is Monsieur Hulot's Holiday from 1953, which was nominated at the Oscars for Best Screenplay.
And we're not going to cover it today, but between that film, Monsieur Hulot's Holiday, and his next playtime, he actually made a movie called Mon Oncle, which would, in fact, win the Oscar for Best Foreign Language Film. So just throwing that out there. Now, of course, his masterpiece comes next playtime from 1967. And last but not least, he would make the movie Trafic in 1971, which would be the final appearance of Monsieur Hulot. He would make another film, Parade, which was more semi-documentary circus film. Didn't really have anything to do with Monsieur Hulot. But that's okay. We're really covering the Monsieur Hulot arc today.
Yeah, because even if Tati kind of got tired of him a little bit, the audience loved him. And we'll talk about that and a little bit of the legacy of Monsieur Hulot as we get into it. So shall we?
Yeah, Jason, take us away.
Monsieur Hulot's Holiday from 1953. In this, as in most Tati films, the plot is rather simple. A man, Tati's own character, Monsieur Hulot, takes a summer vacation at a modest seaside resort where characters from different corners and classes of French society interact in a series of misadventures. But in Tati films, the plot is never as important as the setting and the characters. Hulot is a character set on enjoying the simple pleasures in life amongst a set of people dead set on enjoying their vacation in incredibly particular ways. Ways that do not allow room for the bumbling, charming mess that is Monsieur Hulot. The only other person he sees eye to eye with is a young woman, also there on vacation, with whom he has a series of heartfelt, charming interactions, but interactions that don't amount to much by the end of the film. It's hard to spoil a film without a true plot, and so in the end, Monsieur Hulot goes on his way back to the city in his little beat-up car, leaving us with such a thorough impression of the seaside town that you'd swear you had been there yourself.
All right, Jonathan, before we talk about our movies today, I need to talk about one of my vacation goals. Long-term vacation goals is to go to the French seaside coast and find the hotel where this movie takes place, because it's still there. And in fact, they erected a Jacques Tati statue out in front, which I would definitely take a picture with and pose in a very just, you know, embarrassingly bad manner, because I'm very bad at that.
Or put your hands on your hips and stick your face out, get a pipe in your mouth.
Yeah, perfect. Perfect. I'd find a way to muck it up, but that's okay. That's okay.
So, yeah. But that image that I just created, for those who are unfamiliar with the character of Monsieur Hulot, is what Monsieur Hulot looks like. And he's very kind of cartoonish. He has this very stripped down personality to where he is instantly recognizable on screen because of his certain characteristics.
Man. Very distinctive.
Yeah. Yeah. So he's a very kind of reserved character, kind of bumbling. For Americans trying to get an idea, Rowan Atkinson actually cites Monsieur Hulot as a major influence on his character, Mr. Bean, hence Mr. Bean's Holiday, which also takes place on the French coast. And so other parts of the character are this pipe, which is always sticking out in his mouth, and kind of like basically he leads all of his movements from the pipe. He's always leaning forward. He's, you know, kind of stock still with his legs. And he's also got an umbrella that follows him around everywhere. And he is just kind of like always leaning over, kind of looking into things. And And he doesn't talk very much, which is very interesting, because as we're going to talk about a lot during this episode, these Hulot films, they don't have very much dialogue in them. And what dialogue that they do have is not necessarily important. The fact that the characters are speaking is more important than what they are saying. But they, you can't really replace them as like, you can't really call them silent films, because if you remove the audio, you're also removing a lot of the humor, because there is so much comedy that comes from the sound mixing and the sound effects and even the way that people are talking. Again, even if you don't really know what they're saying, provides a lot of the comedy in these movies.
Yeah, that's definitely true. And, you know, there's a few really beautiful moments created by soundtrack, especially towards the end of, like, you know, Playtime, towards the end of all of his movies, actually. He's got a really unique way to do an ending that's bittersweet and makes you feel both a little sad and a little hopeful at the same time. It's accented very well by music. But in my opinion, outside of that, you could probably do the entire sound mix for these movies with a slide whistle. And
right.
You'd probably be set.
Well, yeah. I mean, the film basically opens this way. We start with a bunch of passengers trying to get on this train, which is coming down different tracks, and they're going up and down different levels of the platform. And there's a loudspeaker, which is very prominent in the frame, but all we hear is... And so the characters can't understand what he's saying, and we don't understand what he's saying, and they're trying to figure it out. And that... basically sets the tone for the entire like track of the audio. So basically we know a person's personality based on how much they're talking. If they're jabbing, it doesn't matter what they're saying. We just know that they're kind of an annoying, chatty, touristy person. And then Hulot doesn't say very much, and he just kind of walks around and finds himself in different situations without having to communicate verbally very much at all.
Yeah. And this is... And we've made all these connections to the silent film. And I think I've mentioned this before when I was talking about his physical acting. But, you know, Monsieur Hulot is like the mid 20th century continuation of the Buster Keaton, Charlie Chaplin physical comedy episodic adventure genre in a way.
It's almost straight out of that, you know. He could have been there in that era doing it with them, being at the top with them. He just happened to come a couple decades later.
Yeah. And he ended up getting a really unique set of problems to discuss. One stuff that's still kind of pertinent today, he talks about in his films. He kind of touches on themes like consumerism. A lot of the people in this film in particular are kind of stuck in playing like their class roles. Like there's the stuck up Marxist who's kind of just stuck being snobbish. There's the consumer capitalist who you see just kind of stuck buying things or consuming things in his movies. While Monsieur Hulot himself is kind of focused on just trying to enjoy the simple things in life. And try to return to kind of, I don't want to say a simpler time, but find the simplicity that's enjoyable in this weird, complex, crazy time that we happen to live in. And he's definitely at the peak of that search in this movie because he's literally on holiday while everybody else is suddenly taking a vacation. Which apparently, and I did some research into this, Jonathan, this kind of mass vacation period started to really happen around this time of of history. You know, beforehand, rich people would take vacations. Poor people or middle class people might take a short vacation here or there, but there wasn't a vacation season as such. Like everybody goes on vacation in the summer.
Right.
And a lot of Mediterranean countries, there's like a whole month where everybody is just off work unless you run like a shop in a vacation town. So
right.
It's this new thing, this idea of everybody being on vacation at once in the seaside town is still a fairly new concept. And it's a little weird when you dig into it in the way that Monsieur Hulot digs into it, all these weird corners around the place. And on top of it, you know, he's just this charming, bumbling guy, just kind of wandering around being this weird, pure character in this impure, complex world.
Yeah, yeah. And this sort of a critique, but almost these films are they have like elements of critique to them about different aspects of society, but they're more observations because they're not necessarily saying that any of these aspects are bad. He's just kind of pointing out the ridiculousness of modern life. And I think that his style of filmmaking is perfect for an observation of this kind of new phenomenon of a mass vacation, because the way that he sets up his comedy in all of these is everything is shot wide. Everything is shot deep focus and wide, so you can see every single thing that's going on. He never uses close-up. I don't think he uses close-up in any of these movies. But what you get is a cast of characters that we're seeing all interacting from a very wide shot. For example, there are many scenes in this cafe on the ground floor of the hotel, and we see from a high wide angle all the characters sitting at different tables, each of them doing different things. And then Hulot will walk in and he will like knock something over or walk in front of somebody who then trips, and then we see this chain reaction and we get to see all of it at the same time. And it's actually interesting because a lot of times what this does is it gives Tati the ability to create layers of visual comedy that are happening in different parts of the frame that do end up interacting. But if you end up missing it at some point, you're not missing the whole joke. And then you can go back and watch it again later, and you're seeing things that are happening in the frame that you weren't noticing before, because they're so intentionally crafted that they're almost like animation. Like everything is done with a purpose, kind of like what we talked about. And I thought about this a lot with Wes Anderson, the way that he makes his film so stylized that everything in his frames has a purpose there.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And I definitely feel that when I watch these movies. It's part of what makes me like Wes Anderson so much, and it's part of what makes me like Jacques Tati so much, is that it's so rich and so complex and so alive and living. And I've talked about this a lot in the past few months, as it's kind of become more apparent to me, and different directors achieve it in different ways. But the idea that the world exists within a movie but outside of the characters, so the world is alive beyond just the main characters that we follow around. And different people achieve this different ways, but the way Jacques Tati does it, and I don't know, that probably wasn't a conscious thought on his part, it's probably just part of his own aesthetic that became this. But the way he does it is by including so much detail, by thinking, oh, this is how this room would actually be. There's not just one thing happening in the room. There's like 10 different things happening in the room. And we're going to look at this, 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 and this, and this is happening over here, and this is happening over here. And it makes it feel just vibrantly real and alive. Like you could just walk into that scene and you would just be in that scene. It wouldn't feel fake. It wouldn't feel like a movie.
Even though a lot of these scenes are very staged, obviously.
So. Oh, yeah, clearly. But, you know, that's the comedic effect. Like, yeah, that seems staged and crazy, but also that could technically speaking happen. And yeah. I'm sure in the wide sampling pool of things that have actually happened at some point in some time in the world, it has.
Yeah. And he also does a really good job kind of on the flip side of that. He knows when to go wide and show a lot of things happening so we can see cause and effect and stuff like that happening in one frame. But he also knows how to do he knows how to be very concise with his visuals, so that if he wants us to see one specific thing, he's able to show us just that. So, for example, in this film, and he does this really well in Playtime, which we'll talk about. But in this film, there's an example where as the different tourists are coming in for lunch, the chef is cutting this pork or whatever. And as the characters walk in, based on their physique, he changes the size of the portion that he's cutting. But all we see in the frame is the door where the characters are coming in. And in the foreground, we're seeing an over the shoulder of the chef with the meat. And so all we see is character and meat slice. So there's no confusion about what's going on in the frame.
Yeah. No, it's very clear. He knows what to show you when. And considering his background, I feel like it's just instinctual with Tati. He's just very, very good at knowing what to show you when, how comedic timing that goes beyond just comedic timing to essentially giving him just straight up good shot grammar, which makes him a good director.
Right, absolutely. And I'm sure a lot of that comes from short films, because with short films, you have to convey a lot of information in a short amount of time. You don't get the luxury of taking the time. So even with these longer films, he's still able to put so many gags and so many situations into one film because he can get those jokes out quickly and concisely.
Yeah, yeah. And the jokes, there's a lot of jokes, and the jokes are very high energy, but there's also a lot of time to breathe in these films.
It never feels rushed.
Yeah, and that breath kind of helps you relax into the scenery and helps you meld even more into this world that's just so rich in detail.
Yeah, and the other thing we should talk about is the fact that these films don't, and we mentioned it in the summary, but it's not plot driven. It's kind of scenario driven, and we've looked at things like that, like with Buñuel and stuff like that, where you're just kind of like taking little slices of life with the same characters. So once we establish all our characters at the beginning, we can kind of throw them in a tennis court or throw them all on a boating excursion or whatever. And then we know their dynamics, and the shenanigans that they get into are understandable, but we can do a lot of different things with them once we've established them.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
That's kind of how vacation works too. You know, if you have like if you have an agenda and you're like, okay, so the first day we're going to go on this excursion, the second day we're just going to go to the beach, the third day we're going to do this. So it actually flows very naturally, even if there's not like a plot that we're trying to follow and know we're going from here to here to here to here to here.
Yeah, 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 yeah. And his films tend to follow that path very well, whether it be the beat of a vacation in Hulot's Holiday, or just the pace of everyday life in Playtime, which is the next movie we're going to talk about.
All right, so yeah, let's get into Playtime.
Playtime from 1967. Playtime centers around two characters and a vacation. This time, though, Monsieur Hulot is the native, and the tourist is Barbara, an American who desperately searches for the old Paris amongst the gray glass concrete buildings, but only catches glimpses of it in reflections on the many windows and glass doors. The film moves fluidly through the course of 2 days in Paris, packed with so many gags and so much detail, you could spend hours picking apart each frame. We start at the airport, with nuns whose habits flap as they walk, and a group of American tourists, including Barbara, landing in Paris. Most of them are interested in shopping. Then we follow Monsieur Hulot on an unknown business errand through a maze of lookalike offices and befuddling bureaucracy. He eventually stumbles into a trade exhibition, crisscrossing the American tourists through the stalls of inconvenient modern conveniences. As night falls, Monsieur Hulot is brought to a series of modern apartments, cold and impersonal, by an old friend. Eventually, the cast collides with one another at a newly built and already falling apart nightclub. There, Monsieur Hulot and Barbara finally meet and become friends. The next day, amidst the morning confusion in the carousel of cars, Monsieur Hulot manages to buy two small gifts for Barbara before she and the Americans depart.
All right, this is the big one, Alex. Playtime. Yeah. Playtime is Tati's masterpiece. It took him so long to make, and it came out the way that he wanted it, which is something that he said basically only happened with this movie.
Yeah, yeah, no, it's incredible. And after I tell you all the work that went into it, you're probably like, yeah, of course it went the way you wanted it. Like, yeah.
Right. He didn't leave any room for it to go wrong.
Yeah, 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 yeah. So this movie came after a long break from the character of Hulot, and then a 9-year production period for this film. That's a long time to make a movie over the course of. And to kind of break that down for you.
And that's including like planning and building and shooting and editing.
Most of that's probably building. And of course, yes, it did take them multiple years to actually shoot this film, but it did take forever to build the set, because everything you see in the movie is pretty much built. All of those buildings are pretty much built. In fact, he basically built a mini city on this in the suburbs of Paris called Tativille. That wasn't his name for it. That was the locals' name for it. And up until that point, 1967, that was the most expensive French film ever made. And of course it was, because, oh my gosh.
Yeah, it's funny because...
He built a whole city for it.
Yeah, but at some point, Tati observed that the amount that it cost to build the city is basically as much as it would have cost just to hire one of the top actresses like Elizabeth Taylor just to star in the film. So it's kind of puts things in perspective a little bit, but it is a very extensive set building process.
Yeah, yeah. And of course, Tati would do this in a lot of his films, and he did it in this one as well. He tried to cast, quote unquote, real people instead of actors as much as possible. He wanted places to feel real and feel beating and have people act like how they would really act. So he was going for that naturalistic idea. And the entire idea of this film in particular was to make a democratic film that was about everybody. And so instead of following a particular character, which we must concede it does do. It follows two particular characters, in fact, Monsieur Hulot and a American tourist in the city. It kind of follows the pace of the city from day to night to day again, and tracks all these different corners. And we see all these characters appear and reappear and come back and appear in this storyline and then disappear in that storyline. And this one, maybe even more so than Monsieur Hulot's Holiday, embraces the themes of criticizing modern day technology and the changes in modern life that were happening.
Satirizing them.
True, very true. And this is one of those ones that there's a whole lot that I didn't catch the first time that I caught the second time around. And I'm sure whenever I get around to watching it the third time, I'll catch even more. A really good example of that, Jonathan, do you remember the scene during the nighttime sequence where Monsieur Hulot goes over to his friend's apartment?
Yes. Yeah. That's great.
Well, there's a back and forth where we're watching from the street. So we're from the street. We're looking through windows and we see sets of people in their living rooms just kind of talking between two apartments.
And both apartments are watching a TV. Both of the TVs are on the wall that conjoins the two apartments. So they're looking towards each other.
Yeah. And the first time I didn't understand what was going on at all. And then the second time I watched it and I realized, oh, the camera angle hides the interior wall. It just looks like they're talking to each other.
And reacting to each other. So one character will walk around towards facing away from that wall and like bend over to put something down. And the characters on the other side of the apartment go, whoa, and like lean backwards and stuff, reacting to the TV. But it looks like they're reacting to him bending over and showing his rear end to them.
Yeah, right. Right. It's very good. And again, like that's Tati being like, hey, isn't it weird that we spend so much time watching something on the wall rather than talking to each other?
Yeah.
Yeah, and there's a million bits like that here. Another one of my personal favorites, just because I got, and this one I got the first time, but I want to point it out again because I freaking love it, is where they're, again, during the nighttime sequence, and I should say, a lot of these, there's a lot of, like, quote-unquote story beats in this film, where we see Hulot, or we see the American tourists, and we see them walk around and interact, and, you know, progress along their days that they're going through, not really their plots, but their days. But there's also a lot of just like circumstantial skits that have nothing to do with anything else. And I absolutely love them. And there's another one during the night scene where a bunch of people on the street are watching on like the third floor of this building while a group of like four or five men are carrying a glass panel down the hallway.
And struggling.
And they're struggling to carry it. And, you know, each one has like a hand on the bottom and hand on the top. And they're all crouched. And they're taking like shuffling steps backward and forth trying to get it down this hallway. But somebody's like playing music. So it looks like they're dancing because you can't see the glass very well. So it just looks like they're dancing. I don't even know if that's satirizing anything. I just love it. It's brilliant.
Yeah. And the way that Tati uses glass and reflections and stuff in this film is amazing. There are so many. I didn't know you could make so many gags using like glass panels and windows and stuff like that. There's a great one where in a really famous scene where at the very beginning, Hulot is trying to catch up with the manager of some business or something. We don't really know what he's trying to meet him for, but the manager goes behind this partition that has glass on one side and like cubicles on the other. And we can see through the glass, through the building to another building, which also has glass windows on the other side. So we can see his reflection across the street, and Hulot thinks that he's in the other building. So Hulot leaves to go and try and catch up with him. And then the manager walks back and he's still in the same building. And it's like, it's so brilliant the way that he had to coordinate all those reflections and everything to work not only like in your eye and for real, but also on camera. It's incredible. And also during the nightclub scene when the big glass double doors, one half of them breaks, but they
somebody
have these
just walks right into it.
Yeah. And then the doorman picks up this huge gaudy like brass doorknob that was on it and just starts holding it open for people and still getting tips even though there's no door there. It's just brilliant.
Yeah. No, the entire thing is incredibly well choreographed, incredibly smart. The entire nightclub sequence could act as its own like short film about descending into chaos as this restaurant is completely finished building itself, or nearly finished building itself, right as it opens, and then proceeds to completely fall apart as it opens.
But the best part is that, like, as they're going around, the American tourists are just so infatuated with everything French that they walk over to like a corner of the ballroom area that wasn't finished yet, and someone like touches the wall and all the plaster comes down, revealing this brick interior, and then a bunch of like planks fall from the wall. So they're like, oh, this is like a rustic exclusive area. And they keep using this one plank as like a bar to keep people out and only some people in. And it's like, that's still like the aesthetic today. The hip aesthetic is to do rustic, like bare brick and all that kind of stuff. That still plays off perfectly, even, I don't know, however many years, like 50 years later.
And like I said before, like all of his satire and critiques or whatever you want to call it, I'm playing fast and loose with the terms today, are still incredibly, incredibly relevant, even up until this day. And I kind of want to, you know, connect this with his use of color. But before I get to the color, I want to talk about the gray and the concrete in this film, because everything goes into the color.
Yeah,
exactly.
That's a big part.
Almost all of it is glass and concrete everywhere. It feels like the old Paris has been the old beautiful Paris of brick and cobblestone and the Eiffel Tower and the river and Notre Dame and all that stuff. It feels like it's been paved over because in this film, like it has been. And the only glimpse you catch of the old Paris throughout the entire movie is when the American tourist, this woman who just wants to see the old Paris and can't find any of it throughout this entire film, opens a door to I guess it's like a travel agency. And in the reflection of the door, she catches sight of the Eiffel Tower. And we see the Eiffel Tower in the background. And that's it. That's it. The only other part of the old Paris that we see, there's like a flower. There's like a old woman selling flowers on the street corner. Uh-huh. But that feels more like it's there for a gag. The only other part of like the warm, friendly Paris of old, of, you know, kind of old, not too old. If it's too old, then it's like the head choppy Paris, and that's not that friendly at all. Monsieur Hulot. He's the only other piece of warmth. In fact, he wears a warm tan jacket or coat, which is a standard part of his attire. He doesn't wear it in Hulot's holiday because, you know, he's at the beach and that would be weird. But
also that film's in black and white, so you can't also, really tell.
Also true. But in this movie, Mon Oncle and Traffic, he does wear the tan coat, and he's the only other piece of warmth in this movie. Now onto the use of color specifically. In this sea of glass and gray, and not a lot of color happening on, It gives.
I think Tati actually said that he wanted to shoot it in color, but as if it were a black and white film.
Right.
And since he's building everything in the scenes, he can make everything just basically devoid of color, yeah, except what he wants.
100% in control of what's going on. And of course, you know, he is able to just put pinpoints of color into scenes and make it really, really pop here and there. You know, during the whole entire sequence where he's chasing this guy who he is never really clear, but it doesn't really matter that he's trying to track down for some business purpose. And through the buildings and the trade show, there's like an orange folder and a blue folder that are being carried around by these characters and help you tell where they are in the scene. And they pop. And
which one you're looking for.
Yeah, and you're looking at them in this massive, massive wide shot of all these cubicles. And you can still tell where they are because you can see that pop of color no matter how small it is because everything else is gray.
Yeah. And this film has such a brilliant opening along those lines where we start in this airport as the tourists are arriving in Paris.
With flapping nuns?
And with the nuns with the little flapping hats, which are ridiculous. But as we're seeing these characters go back and forth, and the airport is all gray again, but there are just like, as the scene goes on and we swap from wide angle to wide angle down different corridors and we see different characters come in and out of different hallways and doors and stuff like that, most of the characters are in very drab gray or black or white clothing. And then there'll just be like certain characters that have a little bit of color to them. Like the janitor comes in and he's got blue. And then in the next shot, there are a couple things with blue in them. And then in that shot, someone will walk by with a red bag. And then in the next shot, we've got little pops of red. So he kind of like fades color into the film from the very beginning. And it's just so brilliantly done that you... Ideally, you don't even notice it except subconsciously. And then as we go on, we've got those little bits of color that we're looking for and that kind of cue us off to what we need to be looking at. Again, going back to that that very conciseness of visual presentation of information. Another example is when Hulot is going up in an elevator. And we go to a big wide exterior of the building. And again, all these buildings are fake. And so there's basically like this yellow card or something that goes up all the windows as like this really visual representation of the elevator going up. It's one of these things that makes me think of cartoons whenever I watch these movies, because in cartoons, you can do that. You can be a little exaggerated and fantastical. And Tati does that even in a live action film.
Yeah, yeah. And you know what, Jonathan? The other day, somebody was asking me what my desert island film would be. Like, what I would bring with me to right. Desert island if I could only watch one movie over and over and over again on that island. And it might have to be Playtime Now. Like, I gave an answer the other day that was a movie I liked a lot. In fact, it's one of my favorite movies. But I think I could get tired of if I watched it on a repeat. But Playtime, it's just so vibrant. You could watch it like 10 times and you might still not have seen everything.
And even once you have seen everything, you can just like be in awe about how much planning and how much goes into making everything come off as well as it does.
It's so immersive in its detail that it's hard to not get sucked into the world, which is just impressive. It's just really good.
Yeah.
Oh man, yeah. My Seinfeld voice came out again. I'm sorry.
So one other thing I want to talk about this film, you talked about it being a democratic film about everybody, and again, it has this big cast. There's a lot of different characters that we can latch on to, and like we talked about at kind of the top of this episode, Tati was a little tired of the Hulot character around this point, and he was trying to get his audience to not be as focused on Hulot. So he was trying to make it so that people aren't just looking for Hulot and ignoring all the other parts of the film, which is actually something that, because that's what audiences were doing, made it not as popular in France when it was released. Among other things, like the fact that Tati mainly wanted it only shown on screens that could project 70mm, which not a lot of screens in France could. But there are all these jokes built into the movie that kind of help us redirect our focus from Hulot. So there's this recurring thing where the manager, who knows he's trying to meet with Hulot, will see someone walking away in a light brown or gray trench coat and a hat and a pipe and think that it's Hulot, and he'll run up to them and they'll turn around and they'll have a beard or something like that. So it's kind of distracting us from that Hulot because we're looking for him too, but that's not the point. That's not the right character that we're looking for. So it's really interesting the way that he kind of subtly tries to wean his audience off of this character because, like you said, he likes so many other things that this character was not what he wanted to focus his whole career on.
Yeah, right. Right. And I love the way he goes about it, too, because it's not like, oh, I'm never going to do this character again. It's like it's almost like this. This film is having like a gentle conversation with his audience about the codependence they have with this character. It's like, yeah, mm-hmm. You know what? Here's a little bit, but we're going to wean you off of him. And also, like, here's a couple comedy beats about how you guys need to let it go a bit. Also, I've never seen this movie in 70mm. I would love to do that.
Yeah, that would be amazing. And it is available. All these films are available on Filmstruck. So I think all of Tati's films are available on Filmstruck if anyone is looking for them.
Yes, literally all of them. And they're all gorgeous. Oh, gosh. How could I forget? Including the number of like shorts he did in between and about things and almost behind the scenes. He actually did... it's half its own thing, half behind the scenes, a short film that was made during the making of Playtime, just because it took so freaking long to make that, you know, you could make an entire short film or probably like several while making the other movie at the same time. But, you know, it's kind of nice to see a different angle of the sets and just see that this big, massive project that was built, you know, got some use out of it. In addition to the, you know, wonderful masterpiece that was made on it.
Yeah. So before we move away from Playtime, I just want to talk about the last scene because it's so amazing. At the very end, as all the characters are getting on buses to leave and go back to the airport, there's this roundabout thing. Again, it's all built and fabricated, but it is completely full of cars and they're all moving at the same pace in this circle, and it's mesmerizing and it's so intricate. And then as we're watching all these cars go around in circles, we get glimpses of the little characters that we've seen in the cars and stuff like that. And it's just, I don't know, just like watching that with all the cars moving, almost like Busby Berkeley level of coordination and mesmeration in one shot.
Yeah, right. It's utterly perfect.
All right, so now let's move on to our final film.
Trafic from 1971. Monsieur Hulot, in his final appearance on film, is now an automobile designer, and he is tasked with taking a crazily designed bright blue and yellow camper van to an auto show in Amsterdam. It does not go smoothly. Tati explores and criticizes almost every aspect of the roadside experience as Monsieur Hulot, a truck driver, and the public relations officer Maria set off to the car show. They run into about every incident and setback you can imagine. Running out of gas, broken down cars, crazy drivers, traffic incidents, Dutch custom officers. Tati goes beyond the problematic to the odd and absurd, touching on such things as gas station oddities for sale, and the fact that drivers alone in their cars tend to act weirdly. Ever notice that you pick your nose when you're alone in your car? Because Tati has. Trafic is perhaps the most plot-worthy and perhaps the most incidental film of all his films. And of course, in the end, Monsieur Hulot doesn't make it on time. It is Monsieur Hulot's swan song, and in it, it is a completely relatable experience for anyone who's ever driven anywhere.
So yeah, Trafic actually kind of has a through line. We have this... We're starting with... this new car that needs to get to a car show. It's really far away, so we're going to drive there. And that's we're anticipating getting to the car show, and all of these shenanigans are happening. So we actually have something to follow rather than a bunch of vignettes. It ends up being a bunch of vignettes, but vignettes along a journey.
Yeah, no, there's actually like something being driven, no pun intended, being driven towards in this film, which is crazy. It's crazy. And maybe that's why this one doesn't do the loop-de-loops and swirls that Playtime or Hulot's Holiday does. It's more straight, streamlined. And maybe that's why it isn't as highly regarded as some of the other Tati films, just because it feels a bit other. But I don't know if that's necessarily fair, because this one's just as complex and smart and clever as the other films.
Yeah. And dangerous, as I noticed. There's a lot of really impressive stunts by Tati and also by the drivers and the way that they use the cars. And oh my gosh, the car crash scene is just like the most bonkers thing I've ever seen.
Yeah, you know, it's absurd. It's way over the top.
But one of the kind of visual motifs that I noticed particularly in this film is Tati uses this really interesting technique of a repetition or a mirror image kind of a thing. And he does this with the cars mostly, but in some other things as well. So a specific example is when it starts raining and we get a montage, as we do several times throughout the film, of people in their cars. But as we're seeing different shots of people in their cars, their wipers are mirroring their personality. So if we have two women that are kind of chatting, and their hands are flailing around a lot, the windshield wipers are just going back and forth sporadically and crazily. And then there's like an old man who's falling asleep, and like one of his wipers is going up and then falling down and kind of going back up again and falling down. And stuff like that. So there's so many of them. But that happens over and over and over again throughout the film in the ways that these visual elements are reflecting the people in the story.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's incredibly. I don't know. What's the word I'm looking for?
I think of it as almost poetic.
Yeah, it is poetic. And I think I would like to describe Tati as like the ultimate people watcher.
Like, kind of, like I said, it's very observation driven.
Yeah. And the things that like he catches people doing behind the wheels of their car when they think nobody's looking is hilarious. Like
the montage of people picking their nose.
Yeah. Yes. That's what I mean. Because that's a thing. That's a thing people do when they're alone in their cars and they think nobody's looking. And now suddenly it's become like a choreographed montage a la the Blue Danube space station waltz at the top of 2001 A Space right. Odyssey, but it's so much more mundane and observational and comedic for the fact that there's like this poeticism to such a mundane, common, but unnoticed activity.
Yeah, and that's the thing that made me think of, which I didn't in any of the films before this one, but it made me think of French New Wave. Obviously, we're talking about Jacques Tati, who worked through the French New Wave, and this is a little bit after that period. But that form of montage and that kind of just observational, detached montage that almost breaks up the scenes in this film definitely felt like it was coming out of that tradition.
Yeah, right? It's still breaking from a traditional narrative in the sense of it's meandering and it's wandering and it's episodic. It's not like nature.
Character arcs and
yeah. And it's still at this time where you're like poppy use of colors becoming a thing, and Trafic, even though like it's not nearly as hyper controlled as Playtime, because it can't be. It's not like Tati could build his own private highway system, although I'm not right. sure he thought about it. There's still a fairly, there's a fairly consistent use of color throughout the film. There's like this blue and yellow theme going on. It's just really nice over the course of the film to kind of tie everything together. I believe there's a point where Hugh Lowe is like walking to get gas because they ran out of gas, and like he's got a yellow gas can, and he stops when he sees somebody else across the street who's got like a blue gas can. And remind me a lot of the folder chase scene in Playtime.
Yeah, the same device. Yeah. Kind of just to wrap up the point about the mirroring images and stuff like that, the color also associates like there's this theme of yellow specifically because the company that they're working for getting this car there for, their brand colors are blue and yellow, this bright yellow. And the woman, the PR lady that's following them around, has this really bright yellow sports car. And one of the themes that Tati says that he's kind of playing on with this film is the idea that people's personalities change when they get behind the wheel. So it's kind of funny. We see this this woman, the PR lady, who's like very in control. She's trying to, you know, straighten out all these messes and stuff. But as soon as she gets into her car, she becomes like a maniac and she just speeds off and she's zipping in and out of everyone. She causes this huge, basic kind of the climax of the movie, but this just huge intersectional wreck where like 20 cars are all like spinning and flying out everywhere. And, but yeah, it's kind of that thing where basically everyone in the film, they can be one way when they're just walking around and talking to people. And then once they get in their car, they just become someone completely different.
Yep, which don't we all? And isn't that Tati's point?
Right. And again, it's this kind of observation on humanity.
Yeah, and it's very tied into the times in which it takes place, when, you know, highway driving was becoming... You know, it was a thing beforehand, but it wasn't nearly as democratic or widespread as it was, you know, in the post-war boom. You know, also we had the time to think about the things we were doing in the post-war boom in a way we weren't able to do during the war. So you get a lot of these observations. But it's also very much set in the times in terms of like the space age technology that gets criticized, nowhere as to the extent in Mon Encore, which that's like the whole theme of that movie, is that technology's nuts. but in this one, you know, you have this running theme of like people watching the moon landing at the background of this movie throughout that sets it even deeper into the period that it takes place in.
Yeah, because the characters that we're following, they're not really paying attention at all because they're like, we got to get to this car show. And everyone else is like, OK, yeah, I'll fix your car in a second. But look, we're like landing on the moon. Humans are going to the moon. but it's also kind of this subtle theme of crossing borders and barriers. So we've got our characters,
the freaking Border Patrol is hilarious.
Yeah, there's a whole scene that takes place in the Border Patrol. But this idea of the characters are crossing borders, they're going across countries to get to where they're going. You know, humans are literally crossing the biggest border that we have to the moon, space. And then also, like, every time that they interact with these people, like the Border Patrol, they all basically become, like, friends by the time they're done showing off this really cool camper car, which is actually really awesome.
but also kind of ridiculous.
It's ridiculous, but awesome. And then also they go to this American mechanic at some point, and he's trying to fix their car, and they end up like sitting down and like staying with him for a couple days, and they all sit down and have a meal. And so it's like this very communal film. Everyone that they interact with ends up bonding over this car, which is kind of a really fun running thing throughout every time that they stop for one of these other scenes.
Yeah, there's like this theme of like growing connectivity throughout, that like while all of this technology is nuts and it's crazy and it's dangerous and it analyzes people in this weird way, like this ability to connect with people all over the place is new and it's cool. And you know, Twitter hasn't come out at this point, so it isn't absolutely awful yet. Oh my gosh, could you imagine what Tati would do if he knew about like social media? I think he'd just cry.
Well, yeah, but it's hard to make a film in widescreen with the theme of social media.
That's true. That's true. It's weird. I bet it's doable, but I bet it's weird.
It's probably just a busy street corner where everyone is looking straight down. There are some great scenes of like really wide shots of like the end of Trafic, which is one of the most beautiful tableaus that he makes, is this huge parking lot, all these cars, some of them moving, some of them not. And it's just started raining, so everyone's got these same black umbrella and they're walking in and out of this grid of cars. And it's, again, it's just this mesmerizing tableau that he's created that kind of wraps up the film. So, yeah, and I kind of touched on this a little bit before, but I feel like this movie has more stunts than the other two. Obviously, there's physical comedy throughout all of these, but there is some really like almost dangerous stuff in this film. First of all, with the dog, I felt for you, Alex. I feel like you had a heart attack 20 times throughout this film because of that darn dog.
It was scary. I've kind of blacked some of it out.
There are like moments where the dog almost gets hit by a car and like people are like kicking it out of the way and stuff like that. Not maliciously, just like because it's there. It's everywhere. And it actually becomes like the focus of a really kind of probably the darkest joke in the whole movie, where these kids pretend, try to act like the dog is dead, and they like roll her car over this this vest that's just as shaggy as the dog is. But there are other things, like, again, in that big, like, intersection car crash scene, there are crazy things, like, there's a car that's on some kind of swivel because it just spins around in a circle, and it's in, like, an exact center axis kind of thing. Again, almost exactly like a cartoon. And there are cars just running into each other and jumping over hills and stuff like that. And then there's a lot of stunts from Tati. Like I was saying, he's not super young in this movie anymore. And yet there's a whole scene where he climbs a tree in order to try and put a trellis back up, this big vine that he had tried to climb earlier and started to knock over. But you're just watching, again, in this wide shot, him climbing all the way up a tree and like leaning over on this branch and practically falling off of the branch. And it's just, it's really impressive. Yeah, the way that it's done, and it makes this movie really exciting.
There's a certain like upbeat pace to this film, and it still finds those moments to breathe here and there. Maybe not as much as like Holiday or Playtime, but this one drives. It goes forward. It's maybe the most relentless of the Tati films. Relentless being like a subjective term. It's not like it's Terminator, but it's it definitely moves at a pace.
But yeah, I think that in all these films, the pace fits the theme. So, you know, we're spending half or practically the whole film like on a highway. So it makes sense for the film to be going really quickly and kind of jumping between these scenes. But then there are those scenes where they'll pull over and try to go to this mechanic shop, and they'll just take the time to breathe and kind of get a little sense of home life and stuff like that. It's very quick pace, but it's also very warm and fun. And I mean, of course, these are all fun, and they're just really, again, impressive ways that Tati is able to manipulate a frame, manipulate the environment, even if he doesn't have complete control of the environment. Like, I'm sure that he did not have complete control of all those cars on the highway. But he does a really good job with just kind of presenting this simple story with so many fun gags and little observations on humanity along the way.
All right, so now let's move on to overall notes. Hey, Jonathan, I think this is the first time we've gotten through an entire podcast without spoiling things, like spoiling the ending of any movie. And that's probably just because there's no way to spoil these movies.
Yeah, they're not spoiler movies. They're just movies where things happen and you enjoy it.
No, if you saw the last scene, it wouldn't ruin the movie if you hadn't seen all the other scenes. You would just you would just have experienced a different part of the vignette, but that's okay. That's all
good. Because often, it's not like the last scene has some huge revelation or bearing on all the other scenes. It's just another piece of this big, picture of humanity that Tati is painting, saying just as much or as little or as simply as any of the other scenes in the movie.
Yeah. No, it's crazy. And, of course, we should note that this is, he did get sick of this character from time to time, and he would eventually retire him. Jacques Tati did play Monsieur Hulot for like well over 20 years, and connected all these movies, kind of form like their own little mini series of sorts, their own little like Monsieur Hulot universe of sorts, if you're into that kind of branding, that connect all of it together in a way that is not unknown, but is very rare in the world of film. There's a few people who've been able to pull off something like that. And the ones I can think of off the top of my head are Charlie Chaplin and Jacques Tati, and that's it. I can't think of another one.
Yeah, because even Buster Keaton or Harold Lloyd's characters, they're not like instantly identifiable like the Tramp or Hulot are.
Yeah, like Keaton and Lloyd would play characters. There would be a different character in each film. But Chaplin would play
the Tramp. They'd be very similar, but it's not the character.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, but Chaplin would play the tramp and Tati would play Monsieur Hulot. And even if they're... Oh gosh, I'm getting so nerdy here. Even if their timelines didn't make perfect sense, like the movies didn't gel with each other, they were identifiably the same character, just thrown into different situations.
Yeah, yeah. And they're also just that identifiable, even visually. You know, you've got, again, Hulot's pipe and his posture and his coat and his umbrella. And you've got the tramp's mustache and his hat and his big jacket and all that kind of stuff. You know, these are the things that, again, make it feel very cartoonesque. And, you know, this is coming after a tradition of kind of Looney Tunes and stuff like that, whereas Chaplin arguably kind of kicked off those kinds of characters. But Tati, even after, you know, that has become a long tradition of things like Bugs Bunny and stuff, where you have this character that has an instant identifiability and this kind of vignette lifespan, lifestyle, different like ways that you can put them in different situations over and over and over again. He's still able to create a new character that falls into the same kind of mold and is, you know, still utterly unique and charming and probably more like insightful. Like he's got all those comedy elements, but he also has that commentary at the same time. It's not just purely for the sake of making jokes.
Yeah, yeah. And it's not like Chaplin wouldn't have commentary in his films. In fact, as he got right. farther into, and we talked all about that. Go listen to that episode. That's like episode like 30 something. Man, right. that
specifically
was
The Great Dictator.
That was a long time ago. It's a long time ago. Episode 30. Man, that was like 40 episodes ago. Anyway, it was a fascinating character who stuck around. And I don't know, he just works so well. And because his canon is so small, like you could, in theory, fit all of the Monsieur Hulot movies together into one story of sorts. Although I feel like it's more of like a portrait of a man's life than a story if you connect all of the movies
together. Yeah, because it's interesting because each of the films you get a little bit of him because in... In Monsieur Hulot's Holiday, you know, we don't know anything about him. He's just a guy on vacation. And then in Playtime, we know he has a little bit of business to do. We don't really know what it is. In Mon Oncle, we get a little bit of his family life. And then in Trafic, we actually do get his occupation, which is the whole point of the movie, as he's this car engineer. So, yeah, it's like each of these films gives us just a little bit of a glimpse into who Hulot is. Not that it really matters for the story, but you're right. Like each of these kind of can be put back to back without really conflicting with each other.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's probably not like a worthwhile endeavor, but it is interesting to think about should you have the headspace for it. And we've tried over the course of this podcast to get this across, but I don't know. It's so hard to find a great way to explain all of the detail that exists within these films, within like a single frame of each of these films and all the expansiveness, especially Playtime, that exists within this one movie, all of the worlds that you see crisscrossed throughout it.
Every single item of every single frame is so intentional.
So particular. It's crazy. And the closest thing I can think to it that comes to it in my mind is another reference. So let me ask you, Jonathan, have you read the book Bluebeard by Kurt Vonnegut?
I have not.
Okay, well, if you or anyone else has ever reads that book or gets to the end of it, there is a description of a painting at the end. And I won't describe that painting, but suffice to say, the detail that they explain that painting is having... this large scene where you can see like thousands of people in this one painting, but you can see the tiniest detail on each of those people. You can count the number of matchsticks in a guy's pocket.
Basically the level to which any character on CSI can enhance a photograph.
Essentially, yeah. That's the closest thing that comes to the detail I see in these Jacques Tati films. That's crazy. This guy went like way overboard in term, and I don't know if that is overboard in a bad way. I just mean as beyond the standard in terms of how far he took his auteurship and being in charge of freaking everything down to like the tiniest detail.
Yeah, it's incredible. And also, I think another interesting thing that we haven't really talked about too much about these films is that each of these films has this really interesting mix of characters, this kind of hodgepodge of characters from a lot of different places and a lot of different backgrounds. But they all just kind of like interact and so, for example, like we have characters that just switch languages that they're speaking. They speak English or French kind of interchangeably. And again, a lot of the times it doesn't matter what language they're speaking. And I think that's why this kind of switch of language works so well. There's a little bit of a commentary in that about the prevalence of English in France, or also Franglish, as I think it's actually called. But it's just really interesting to see like how we can watch this film and probably understand the same percentage of the dialogue as a French person watching these films as it switches between English and French, sometimes without even bothering to be very consistent. Like there are points in Trafic where the PR lady is speaking English to someone who responds to her in French, and they just don't even bother like translating to each other because they just both understand it, I guess.
And even though all the characters in these films are so fascinating, like at the end of the day, it feels like we're using Mr. Hulot's lens to get to view this portrait of a place and a portrait of a time and a portrait of a society of people rather than anyone in particular. See them interact, see how they behave, see the humor in how they behave, and maybe come away with something deeper while we see some of the things that we do that are so ridiculous.
Yeah, and in a fairly timeless way. Like, there are some things that are fairly of the times, but they say things that are pretty universal. So, for example, the switchboard operator, or whatever you call him, at the beginning of playtime, whenever Hulot is trying to make his appointment, is this old man, and he's got this basically wall of buttons and switches and stuff, and he's trying to figure out which one he needs to click to use the intercom. And he's like, let me see. Oh, yes, I think it's this one. And then a bunch of lights come up. He's like, oh, wait, no, maybe not that one. Maybe it's this one. And it's like this idea of trying to keep up with the technology and keep up with the ever increasing complexity of technology is ever present, even if that device never even existed or never will exist.
I've got one of those in my apartment. I don't know what you're talking about.
A wall of buttons and lights.
Yeah, it doesn't do anything. It just lights up. It's just there.
It's actually an intercom to my apartment. That's why I hear you random times.
Oh, yeah, that would explain. Oh, man. Some of the things you heard. Me cussing at computers, trying to get them to work.
Waiting for appointments that clack their heels down the hallway for 5 minutes.
Jeez.
That's such a great shot.
That's a wonderful, wonderful bit. The chairs that sink way too far and make farting noises when you sit in them.
Yeah, again, the sound effects, we didn't talk about them too much after Monsieur Hulot's Holiday, but the sound effects in all of these are, again, cartoonish to the level of, cars spinning around going woo, 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 or whatever. Like you said, you could use a slide trumpet to basically dub the entirety of these films, and you'd still get the same effect. Fun fact about dubbing these films, two fun facts, actually. Playtime is entirely dubbed after the fact, which is very obvious sometimes, other times not so much. And also, apparently, the English version of Monsieur Hulot's Holiday was entirely dubbed by Christopher Lee. I don't know how that works, but I want to watch that version.
That's so random. Anyway,
a little off topic, but fun facts.
Let's talk about what we're going to talk about next week, Jonathan. What are we going to talk about?
All right, next time we're getting around to something that we've been wanting to do for a long time, and we've touched on here and there, but we're getting to film noir as we get into October and we are anticipating Halloween. We get a little bit darker, and we're going to be talking about The Maltese Falcon from 1941, Double Indemnity from 1944, and Touch of Evil from 1958, directed by Orson Welles, who we just did recently, so go back to that.
Yeah, and we're going to try to make a conscious effort to mix up the order in which we tackle different topics on the podcast so that we don't have long stretches where we're talking about highly relatable and movies that you know about, and then a very long stretch where we're talking about foreign films that you've never even heard of. We're going to try to mix it up so that everything's sprinkled throughout and make it a little easier to follow along and try to make sure there's a little something for everybody along the way as we continue talking and we continue for another 70 episodes.
Because there, as we are constantly reminded, we will not run out of content for this podcast anytime soon.
No, there's too many movies.
We are currently at... Oh, no, we did it this week. Playtime is our 200th film that we've talked about. We're up to 201 after Trafic.
Oh, wow. That's something.
So there you go. Go to Letterboxd or our blog to see a full list of films that we've covered. Find your favorite or find one that you've never heard of before and listen to us talk about it.
Well, that's about all the time we have for this episode.
If you have movie suggestions for us or just want to reach out, I can be found on Twitter at @JSSatchel.
And I'm at Alex Garinger.
And I'm at TheBlueJay1994.
And to find links to the things that we talked about today, you can view them on the blog at thefilmlinks.com.
If you like the show, let us know. Leave us a review on iTunes so other people know what we're all about.
We definitely appreciate it.
Talk to you next time.
All right, see ya.
That's
it's
okay.
Like, apparently it's like National Coffee Day.
Every day is National Coffee Day, Jonathan.
I know, right?
Yeah, like, no, my boss the other day was like, yeah, man, my optometrist told me I had high blood pressure. And he was like, yeah, I drink a lot of coffee every day. I drink like 2 cups a day. And I was like, oh, man.
That's it?
That's nothing.
I drink you 2 cups before lunch.
Yeah, like, come on. At this point, like, I'm just, I don't feel it anymore. It's just, I gotta have it. Like,
it's just a thing that you do, yeah.
Yeah, no, I'm just solidly addicted. If I ever stopped drinking it, I would go into withdrawal. But, like, for now, I'm dialed in. Says the man drinking an entire bulk bottle of Starbucks Caramel Macchiato.
Like, from the bottle.
From the bottle.